off-grid and free, my path to the wilderness. Written and narrated by Ron Melchiore in the wilderness of northern Saskatchewan. Published by Moon Willow Press, year 2016. Chapter 1. Which way do I go? "There's a bear at the door," shouted my wife, Johanna. She had gone downstairs to fetch a book and had heard a strange noise at the front door. Looking over, she was startled to see a pair of large paws groping at the door window pane, the claws making telltale click, click sounds on the glass. I raced downstairs, grabbed the shotgun, and was out the door in a flash, barely pausing long enough to put on my shoes. The bear, sensing my frantic activity, had not stuck around. By the time I managed to get outside, our intruder was making a beeline for the cover of the woods. Nevertheless, I fired a warning shot. A loud boom reverberated through the air, and for emphasis, I shouted a few choice words to discourage a return visit. Fortunately, I've never had to use our thunder stick as anything other than a noisy deterrent. It's an alarming sight to see a bear at the door. The animal's bulky outline framed by the door window, as if it were a wildlife picture mounted on a wall. A couple thin panes of window glass are all that separate you from the bear. There's only one reason it's there, and it's not to make a delivery. It wants in. Generally, building access doors swing to the inside, but our front door swings out, an inadvertent but lucky choice. An animal would need manual dexterity to turn the doorknob and pull the door outward before gaining entry to our home. Unless it's smarter than the average bear, it will likely try pushing inward, then give up when nothing happens. Horror stories abound of marauding bears breaking into unoccupied cabins and wreaking havoc. Contents, including mattresses, can be dragged outside and are gnawed and shredded, while cabin interiors, rummaged in the search for food, don't fare any better. Bears, with their long claws and strength superior to a man's, can be terribly destructive. Our metal-clad freezer has indentations on the lid that serve as a visual reminder of the power of those claws. Long canine teeth, used in conjunction with powerful jaw muscles, have left scars and puncture wounds on our snowmobile and boat motor. Although we have little fear of bears when we are close to the homestead, we are alert and cautious when they're coming out of their dens after a long winter's hibernation, especially when a mother and her cubs are together. Hunger is the driving factor as they go about foraging for food. Black bear, the species in our area, are the least aggressive bears in North America. But on rare occasions, we hear a news report of someone being mauled or killed, so the bears need to be respected. Surprising a bear is a good way to get into trouble. So if I venture into the woods, an occasional warning shout gives any animal in the area a heads up that I'm passing through. My wife and I have lived in bear country for the last 36 years, first in the state of Maine, and now in the wilderness of northern Saskatchewan. The above incident is just one of the many occasions we've encountered bears, with the majority of those encounters being short, fleeting glimpses. Most members of the Ursin community will run as soon as they spot us, but a curious bear may stop to view us from a distance. When a bear is near and shows no fear, it's time to be concerned. In that event, they've become a little too accustomed to being around humans, or worse, their hunger has overcome any natural fear they normally have. Neither situation is good. A fortuitous series of events brought us to this place. A remote lake, far out in the Canadian wilderness, 100 miles from the nearest supply point. And by wilderness, I mean the real thing. As far as your eye can see, from the vantage point of a floatplane high above the ground, you can gaze upon an aerial tapestry of multi-hued green forest, intermingled with jutting rock formations, lowland bogs, and glistening lakes. Exposed rocky hilltops, sparsely vegetated with stunted trees that have managed to gain a tenuous foothold, along with low shrubbery and lichen, are sure signs you are flying over Precambrian shield, a dominant surface feature in the north. Serpentine rivers and streams cut through the landscape, the rivers occasionally flashing a churning white, where rapids lie in wait for the unwary canoeist. All of this is the perfect habitat for wildlife and outdoor adventurer alike. We are surrounded by pure virgin forest, where the only human tracks are our own, and the only neighbors are animals. There are no roads or trails to get here. We are well beyond any population centers, and a flight on a floatplane is the only way you will reach us. The electrical grid, which the majority of the world's population relies on to power industry and appliances, was left behind the moment we took off from the floatplane base. We severed the electrical tether by vanquishing the utility company long ago. We know we live here, at this particular location, and yet we have no street address. Our address is a set of coordinates, a latitude and longitude, given in degrees, minutes, and seconds. With the area so vast, any plane seeking to find us best be accurate down to the second, lest the plane fly by and miss us completely. There are no traffic signs, no mileage indicators, no flashing neon lights telling a guest they are closing in on our off-grid homestead. Our location is a mere pinprick on the Earth's surface, blending in with mile after mile of picturesque landscape. Generally, twice a year we fly out for resupplying appointments. These biannual trips out are the only times we pick up our mail, buy food, and interact with other humans. At epical turning points in our lives, each of us are faced with the question, which way do I go? I've asked myself that key question many times throughout my life, and my answer has always been to take the least traditional road. Of course, each of us has our own, what should I do, which way do I go moment. We each have our own road to travel, a lengthy road of blessed with health, but where every step along the way is a potential encounter with a roadblock, twist, or fork. I've certainly opted to take a few forks. Who would have thought that living in the Canadian wilderness at this point in our lives would be the destination for my wife and me? Certainly not I. Over the years, I have been urged by friends and countless strangers to write a narrative of some of the events that have occurred in my life. I resisted for a time, but I've compiled some true stories, interspersed with some humor, arranged in a loose chronological order. I hope you will find these stories entertaining and informative. I'll share accounts of survival and living in the Canadian wilderness, of hiking the Appalachian Trail in winter, of cross-country bicycling, and of the horror of watching my world catch on fire. I write and pass on these experiences to provide encouragement for others to pursue their dreams, regardless of how far-fetched those dreams may be. If you are as lucky as I have been, you will have the support of your family, spouse, or both. Which way do I go? Let's start at the beginning by heading north to Maine. Chapter 2. Northbound to Maine. Exhausted from an overnight drive, I was motoring up a desolate stretch of I-95 in northern Maine, well beyond civilization's background glow of lights. It was a perfectly clear, starlit night during the early, dark morning hours, when I saw the northern lights beckoning to me for the first time. I was on a mission to search for a suitable site for an off-grid homestead, and this light display would be the first of many times I would enjoy watching it through the years. Since I've lived in northern latitudes for the last 36 years, viewing the lights is now a common occurrence, but at that time, it was quite the novelty. Ironically, I began life in an urban setting. Born in the city of Philadelphia, I could never have envisioned the stepping stones of events that would lead to that long drive up a lonely stretch of I-95 so many years ago. I grew up in the nearby suburbs and led the life of a normal kid. I didn't do exceptionally well in school, and averaged B to C grades. Not applying myself to my studies, I chose sports and music as the outlet for my high-energy drive. As a young guy, I played drums in a rock and roll band. Many cities have a large arena where concerts are played. Perhaps you've heard of the Spectrum in Philadelphia? Back in those days, It was the go-to venue for lesser-known bands as well as the famous...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.